Moving Fundraising Forward, a podcast on how to get the most out of your fundraising while building a stronger team. Today, we are joining our hosts, Jim Boshin and Rob Pike, as I welcome our special guest, Chrissy Buckley, Vice President of Development for Raise the Future.
Rob Pike, Chrissy Buckley, welcome.
Thank you.
Chrissy is our special guest today, and she is the Vice President of Development from Raise the Future. Rob, if you'd like to introduce.
The big smile on my face is because Chrissy and I have known each other for a while, and she's the first guest I've asked to be on. So Chrissy, we'll start just a little bit about you, where you're at. Actually, before I go there, like, just a little bit how you got into this.
Yeah.
You didn't wake up one day saying, I'm going to be a fundraiser.
No, certainly not. No, well, thank you for having me, Rob. Thank you for inviting me. I'm excited to be here. So right now I work for an organization called Raise the Future. And I would say the big reason why I'm there is just because of my prior experience and just passion for nonprofits. I think I've been always so lucky to find nonprofits that are really working to try to figure out a solution and maybe even work itself out of a business, and to be a part of something along those lines has just been so fascinating. So at Water for People, or at Raise the Future, which I'm at now, that's really what our focus is really how do we empty the foster care system? What does that look like in a state? Yeah. What does it look like in, you know, to do it across the country? And so that's been really exciting to be a part of. And
is that a national organization? Is it across a number of states?
It's across three states. We do have kind of some national work we do around capacity building and stuff. So
very cool.
It's very, very unique, wonderful place. Yeah. And one of the reasons why I got into fundraising, I would say, is I did get my degree in international human rights. But really from there, I think once you know a little bit more about international issues, the best thing that we can do, you know, being from North America, the United States, is really amplify the voices of the people who are trying to solve problems on the ground. And so once I joined an organization who was really trying to do that, I just felt like it was amazing to be on the fundraising end. It really is a superpower, I feel like. You know, it's the number one thing that really prevents the nonprofits from achieving their impact, from working themselves out of a job, is really attracting the investments that they need to accomplish that.
Yeah, and did you think that way when you started out in fundraising?
Oh gosh, no.
Yeah, well, what was it? Because you were getting on, you get into programs, and you started your field abroad. Is that where did you start?
Yeah, I did. I lived in Ecuador for
right.
a year, and then decided to go get back and get my degree and got a part-time job at Water for People.
Okay. And then how did you, like, one day, hey, Chrissy, you're a fundraiser?
No, it was just the part-time job was in fundraising. Right. They needed someone to stuff envelopes, yes. Yeah. And it worked around my class schedule.
Yeah.
So, it was really there, I think. I was always trying to figure out how I could work with programs people, and then just realized that, no, the best way to solve solutions is to empower local communities to do so. And that's really what fundraising allowed me to do there, is connect people who want to make a difference in the lives of people in different countries, and then just show them how.
Well, it's, you know, we were talking about this, Jim and I, you know, we did, of course, we always do prep because good people do prep. We had a little conversation with Chrissy, and the way you own this idea that there is incredible ability to help create change via your position of fundraiser.
Mm-hmm.
And talk a little bit more just around, you know, how you see that playing out and how that's maybe evolved a little bit through your career.
Well, I think to be a good fundraiser, you really need to know what you're selling. You know, you need to know the whys, the hows. You need to ask yourself those hard questions. You got to ask your program team those questions. And I think as you meet with investors, they start to ask you questions, and as they start to learn more, they learned how to ask harder and harder questions.
Yep.
And you know what? That actually is the piece I think I love the most, is really just jumping in and learning the how and the why we do things and what we're doing to try to improve. And I really think that's what ultimately makes the best investor relationships, when they're along the ride with you.
Yeah. So do you feel that the profession of philanthropy attracts you to this industry, or is it the passion for the causes that you have the opportunity to support that pulls you into this profession?
I don't know if I can really separate those too much. You know, definitely I probably would say cause, mm-hmm. but I see philanthropy as the vehicle to make that happen.
You know, as part of that dynamic, because we've known each other for a while now, you really own that space of, it's a dialogue. Mm-hmm. So I guess walk me through the history of, this is like this hard questions as a fundraiser. How did you feel about them when you first started getting them? I mean, how do you feel about them now? And what's that transition been?
We'll say again, like, how do I feel about what?
When people ask hard questions, questions. You're in front of the prospect and they're like, I'm going to grill you for 5 minutes.
Oh my God. Like anything early in my career, you just feel like when you go and sit down in front of a funder, you better know everything and mm-hmm. you better give them the best pitch and you better just talk all the details out to show them that you know. They don't, and then it doesn't take too long, especially with your numbers, to realize right. that that's the worst way to do philanthropy and fundraising yeah. because the people's heads turn off, you know? So yeah. I think it was the common, you know, it was hard, I guess, at first when you would get those hard, after you thought you did all your homework and you didn't, you know, and people ask those hard questions and you feel like you don't have the right answer. But after you grow and you really understand relationships, which fundraising is all about relationships.
All about relationships. Yep.
It really is more of that dialogue and back and forth. And if you don't have that answer, you know, it's about the trust that you'll go and find it. And mm-hmm. if you don't, you know, you can go back to your team. And I think that really is it. I mean, fundraising is so much about authenticity. Mm-hmm. You've got to be yeah. able to feel like your funders have to feel like they can trust you and that yeah. like, you know.
Can you talk a bit more about your experiences and those conversations, like how you felt that's changed a bit as you talk about evolved over feeling like you have to know everything about what it is you're talking about to just being authentic to saying, you know, let me mm-hmm. talk about some of the wonderful things that we're doing, the impact we're making, and trying to find that commonality where they can be a part of that solution.
Yeah, well, that's, I think, what I've learned over time is that you really have to start out with those questions. You have yeah. to figure out what's in your prospect's head. Mm. And once you really have an idea of the foundation of the why behind your prospect, what they give to, why they give to it, mm-hmm. then you actually are automatically fed with so many connections if you know your work about how we also are accomplishing that on the ground.
And I'm going to brag about Chrissy here for a while. There was a group we worked early on. It was a toothpaste company.
Yes.
Chrissy was doing a great job dialoguing with him, but we realized that they weren't getting executive support. And you're dealing with community relations, you deal with marketing. And so you really did a good job. We went empathetic. Mm-hmm. And you really got in the head. And we decided what they needed was a boost from the CEO. Mm. So Chrissy drafts a letter from her CEO to the CEO of this company, multi-billion-dollar company. What happened 4 weeks later? We got a letter in the mail, a handwritten really? Note.
Yeah, though it was typed on an old-school typewriter.
That's right. And after that, it just you just moved so much faster with the prospect.
Mm-hmm, yeah, I agree. I do think that is true. Even sometimes when you're dialoguing, especially with corporations too, mm-hmm. they're even intimidated to go to their leaders, but yeah. when you go with an authentic message about mm-hmm. really trying to change the world and yep. show them how, people jump on board.
I'm gonna ask you a couple questions as we go, because I think you're just a great example of a person that you came in for the cause and you still focus cause probably first, but the level of that you focus on the craft is you're one of the elites. It's just fun to be around you. What are some of the big lessons early on or tools that you're like, okay, once I got under this or this, I understood some of these things, I started to really be able to move?
I would say for me, getting really good around visits and asking really comes with doing the work ahead of time. Hmm. So really understanding your prospect. Yeah. I mean, gosh, early on you even gave me this advice. You were like, go in, see what she's written, write down her quotes, like, you know, really try to get it in her head. Mm-hmm. And gosh, since then, I have to say, you can show up on a visit in a totally different way.
Oh, interesting.
Because you really yeah. have built a different story, and you know a little bit more about that prospect when you're going in, and it gives you confidence.
And they're not a stranger anymore.
Yeah, exactly.
Something that you actually feel like you know.
Yeah. And there's always, and you find, and I watch people do this, and you do as well. There's a fundraising is an interesting dynamic because if you do this well, there's a point where you're almost crossing the line and you're worried more about the philanthropist than the organization, right? Because I'm going to help you and I have to help you. And I'm getting in your head to make you have the happiest, best gift you've ever made. Mm-hmm. It was just wonderful.
Yeah. And then when you go into those visits, yeah. I mean, I learned a lot about altitude framework from you, but really, you know, what is your crystal clear message that's at the highest level? The 30,000 foot level is what we always used in our training.
Yeah.
But really, that's where all the agreement happens. Mm. It's really when you start to get lower into the details where sometimes donors can be like, I don't like this, or I don't like that, or I don't want you to do it that way. So I think the more time you can really spend in that why, that highest level, mm-hmm. and have dialogues around there and impact, I think that's really where that's the place that people give from.
Yeah, they buy at the why.
They buy at the why, yeah. So don't spend too much time on the how, and especially not the 3 inch details.
In your world, right, there's always good leadership, but there's how much time do you usually, well, let me rephrase the right way. How have you learned the craft of helping people share their story more at the why?
How have I?
Or maybe a specific example, right? Because when we work with program people, they're in the details all day long. And all they want to do is talk about what they think about all day long, which is, I moved this thing here. I made this social worker do this or.
Mm-hmm. Well, I would say everything with program people, they have to be comfortable with you being the facilitator of things and you kind of coming in. So I've tried to do altitude with our program people.
Mm-hmm.
And it's really a difficult thing for them because they live so much in the details and stuff. So I do think that the questions you ask, especially if you bring them on a program visit, having program people share their why, that helps them stay up in a higher level. Yeah. And then you also have to just be comfortable with kind of interrupting and just saying, hey, Rob, that is a great explanation, but why don't you talk about this? Always or pointing back to a story and bringing it back up.
That's what you just, because you have to own the space. Part of that is, I think, you can't expect people in the programs to know and do what you do, which is professional facilitation of giving.
Yes.
But you can show them that you have a way of doing it.
Mm-hmm.
So that way they follow you a little better.
Oh, for sure. Yeah. And that's why prepped is so critical.
And when you say, go ahead.
What are some of your methods for finding some of your best prospects?
Oh, it always starts with your current funders and your current list. And I think it's amazing. I mean, you taught me that. It's amazing to realize when you really put it to the test, have you really maximized all those relationships?
Mm-hmm.
And what does it mean to maximize all those relationships? And I think really taking that lens to each and every person who gives, just because they give doesn't mean they're not a prospect. Mm-hmm. They're still a prospect for the following month, year, whenever it is. It's to really look at that first. And then once you really maximize and have a great relationship with those prospects can be landmines full of... I shouldn't say landmines.
Yes.
We don't want the blower down, but sure.
They are full of potential prospects that can help you get connected. I do think one thing that's really important, though, is you have to make sure that whoever you're going for does have a connection to the cause. Mm-hmm. And then really understanding your ability to get to that person, I think, helps factor how much time you should put on that. Mm-hmm. Because if you really can't find anyone to give you a warm lead or any way to get in front of that prospect, maybe you need to look at your second prospect because you don't want to spend too much time on those harder ones to get. So I think it's a combination between understanding, their connection, their ability to make the type of gift that you're hoping to get, and
so
to get a visit.
Tease up one of my favorite Chrissy Buckley stories. So there's... because now I'm hearing you not talk as a almost like a major gift officer or first time, but as a leader of major gift officers, which is, listen, you can talk about that person all you want, but if we don't have a way to get in at speed, it's a bit of a wild card right now. But there was a prospect when we were at Water for People, hotel family on the West Coast. Yep, yes, you know who I'm talking about. And I kept saying... Chrissy, I don't think it's a great prospect. I just don't. And the look in her eyes, remember this? Like I remember I was on a big board, we were doing strategy. I'm like, Chrissy, I just don't see it. And the look in your eyes was like, I don't care. I'm going to go do this one. And we gave the wild card, right? Chrissy, okay, great. And it proved out to be a
$3 million
later. Congratulations. Yeah. Right? So this is the where, as you think about your leadership now, how do you make sure you're leveraging people's passions, but also keeping them on track to reality?
Yes. I think that's a really good question to ask. You have to hire good people, and you have to hire people also that you trust. And as you're cultivating their skill and their craft, is really having that trust within them. And I think at some time, if you know them and you trust them, and they ask you for a wild card, you've got to be able to empower them. Yeah. You can empower them within limits, you know, and really trying to help figure it out. But like, I had a gut instinct with them. I knew I had a really good relationship with the program officer. And although they had never given to Uganda before, and this is a big family that had very, very specific strategy, I just knew that connection and that passion that I had with that program officer, that we could really change things. And it took a year and a half, but we changed.
Somebody guessed that $3 million.
Yeah.
You were doing your mind mapping session and it wasn't connecting all the right boxes for that one. But and good for you. I mean, congratulations and going with your gut. Sometimes you just have to do that. Not everything just checks a box.
As you do with your people, to Chrissy's point, it's Chrissy had the look in her eyes and she was committed to doing things right. And I trusted that she would give it her best shot, and she wouldn't let that detract from all the other things going on as well. Mm-hmm. And it was like my best bad coaching moment of my life.
We've all had them.
Yeah. I just wish I had more of them.
Me too, Rob.
Yeah, that'd be nice.
So I would ask you, so you're talking about the trust and development staff that you work with, that you hire. What do you look for in a development officer? Whether it's a kind of the annual giving sustaining type person or the major gift officer role, what do you look for? What are some of the qualities that you look for in development people that you bring on board?
Oh, yeah. Number one is attitude. Yeah. attitude. Yeah, I can't say it enough.
Answer. Yeah.
You know, really, what is their attitude? Are they collaborative? Are they positive? Are they hopeful? Because that is really, truly the message that we are trying to bring to the external world, is that there is hope and we can solve these problems. So I think that passion and that hope has to be there for sure. I do believe that you've got to have a little bit of an ego, because you've got to want to get that visit. You've got to want to close those big gifts. Yeah,
well said.
And a little more of a thicker skin with that, because of that ego too.
Exactly. But not so much that it would cause you to turn on your teammates. Like, you really have to be team oriented. Yeah. Because, oh my God, do you need them? I work at an organization right now that's very big on the brain and how the brain works. And we have this saying that our best conversations have when people are talking cortex to cortex. Well, there are times when we all get stressed in life or something horrible has happened to us and we need to borrow someone else's cortex. Mm-hmm. And I have definitely had to do that on fundraising, where I had a visit that I needed to execute and execute well. But you know what? I had a really, really rough morning. Something had happened. And so I have colleagues now that I can be like, hey, I just need to borrow your cortex. Can you come on this visit with me? And just having that person with me to back me up really helps.
Yeah, I love that, because I know in some development programs that we've worked with over the years.
Wow, that's awesome.
There are silos. You know, people have those silos. And I've got my certain number of people I need to go see.
Yeah.
And if I bring something along, do I have to share that credit? Do I have to share that gift? And it's not to say that it's not for the greater good of the organization. It's not about us. It's about the organization. But, you know, do I want to expose myself to that too?
Yeah.
You know, if somebody's coming with me or I'm going with somebody else.
And... Yeah. And I think, you know, at that point, Chrissy, if I'm listening at home right now, I'm writing this down. I'm having a talk with everybody. It's about cortex sharing when we need it.
I love that. Yeah, it's a great.
How many big visits do you do without help?
Oh. Hardly any.
None.
Yeah.
Why? They're too important.
They're too important. They are.
Yeah. And so you're bringing in your best, and there's too often this myth that, well, if you're the fundraiser, you should do it in isolation because that's your job. And or you hire people that are competitive with each other, but not competitive with themselves. Yeah. And so they beat it.
And that's a sales.
That's a sales
kind thing. Of mentality too. Things too. So.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. No, I just, time after time, more brains in a, well, it can't be too many, but more than one brain in a visit is always superior.
Always. And I like the cortex. Yeah. I'm going to steal that one. It's going to my book.
Yeah. And I love the piece about looking for attitude. I think that that's been something that we've talked about for years, which is if you hire for attitude, the skill can come with that too, mm-hmm. obviously, but you can add to that. You can help educate and bring somebody up to a level of maturity where you can send them out to do that work. Attitude is everything. So congratulations on that one.
And on that one, because you
had good coaching.
I want to kind of transition a little bit to putting on your leadership hat here. In the fundraising world, right, there's all these other functions. We just mostly talk about major gifts. Mm-hmm. How do you get the attitude and how do you support those that are, you know, they're doing the annual fund, that are doing research, to know that they're feeling validated and part of the bigger effort here, even though they might not get, you know, $1 million gifts?
I know.
Yeah. Because without them, you wouldn't have time to get $1 million gifts.
Oh, man. It's all about team selling, yeah. You know, and that's really the way I've always structured any team I've built is, you know, you're looking for the right people to be on the right seats on the bus. So there are people that on my team who are so passionate about everything that we do that would love to sit behind a computer and write about it all day. And you tell them to go put them, and they have an amazing attitude. If you ask them to go sit in front of a donor and ask for a lot of money, they shut down. That is just not the way that they want to partake in this work. So I think by having that team sales attitude, knowing that every single person on that bus, it takes every single person on that bus to close that gift is really helpful. But I also think it goes back to what you're measuring for accountability with your team. And then also how you are announcing that to the organization, how you're celebrating the wins. You know, all of those things can't be about one person. Mm-hmm. It's really got to be about the team and really pulling that out, because then you have a lot more motivated people to continue to do their part because they feel ownership over that gift.
And they all share in the success as well.
Exactly. Yeah,
that's fantastic.
Well, she's just like, we've been doing podcasts around that exact subject, and you probably consolidated to a sentence that was better than 3 podcasts.
Oh, I don't know. That's not true.
how do you get people to understand, and how are you celebrating?
Oh, it really comes with, I think it has to come with everything. It has to be in your DNA as a leader. So at our team, our organization right now, we use Teams. Mm-hmm. And so really big on shout outs and successes. Mm-hmm. So it has to do with how you are framing that. And when you do decide to announce it, we also, a really important part of my job as a leader in development, the organization, is to make sure everyone understands revenue. They understand how the funding comes in so that they don't get frustrated on like, why can't I do this? Or why can't we do this? So that they really understand. And I work at a human services organization and never had to deal with more complex funding streams in my entire life.
Yeah,
you know,
state,
government
federal,
funding streams.
Yeah.
Yes, you can use the red pen, but you can't use the red black pen, you know, not really, but sometimes it feels like that. Yeah. So really helping to educate the rest of the organization on that. And then once that also helps to celebrate the positions that are on the team that really make those revenue pieces come in when people really understand the work it takes to get the money in the door.
This is just so much fun because, is you know, you're talking at such just a leadership culture level.
Oh.
And it takes work and a lot of reps. Uh-huh. But they're, you know, you're getting people to understand the nuances of your work and how it relates to them, and you're celebrating them in that process.
Mm-hmm.
Just kudos. That is it's well done.
Thank you. Yes. And I have to say that the culture of my nonprofit also helps to just facilitate that type of a true appreciation for everyone who works there. We've got a really good culture.
I think if thinking of culture, as you're working with your team or someone's new coming on, if you're leading someone new, what are some of the things that you probably know they're going to make mistakes around, but you're going to coach them and not beat them up around?
Oh my God, yes, that's everything. That is everything. Like people, like when you hire them and you're training them and they can't be scared to come with you with mistakes. They absolutely can't. So creating that adversarial relationship with someone you're bringing on will just hurt your team, hurt your organization, hurt everything. So I think by building trust, I mean, that really is truly what I mean, is that they feel safe with me, that they feel safe to tell me when they've messed up, and they feel safe right away, that they don't like hide it and be shameful about it for a couple of weeks. And so I talk openly about my mistakes. Like we have several meetings, a group.
Love that.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
I think it's just, yes, it's about owning the mistakes. And there's so many times that I think staff, especially in fundraising, can feel like they messed up. You know, you could have an upset funder and maybe it had nothing to do with that person. There's so many reasons why it feels like, I can understand. And I've been that employee. You feel like you want to just hide and not let anyone know about that. Yeah. But it festers and it gets uglier. And so the more culture you can create about owning mistakes and learning from them, I think the better we all are.
Did you get that from through the your experiences, or did you get that in an environment that you worked in your past work?
Yeah.
Was that an environment that you worked in that you kind of said, I'm going to emulate that as I go forward? I really like this. As I'm new to the industry, I can go in and feel safe that I may make mistakes, but at least I have somebody that I can have as a mentor that can help me through those mistakes and show me how to do it differently next time. Or is that something
you see what not to do?
Or or maybe you saw what not to do and said, you know, I'm not going to. Yeah,
that was more of it. I worked under a person who was very, very negative and very, you know, finger wagging at you. And it drags you down so much that I just knew that when I became a leader, I wanted nothing to do with that. But it really was at my current organization. Mm-hmm. I really understood the importance of it because we do so much work on the brain and how to get people to be receptive to messages and all that stuff. Mm-hmm. So I really learned a lot more scientifically about how to create good, mm-hmm. trusting relationships. And I think luckily I had some intuition coming into it, but then I've also learned the science behind it and and then experienced the success of a team that trusts each other and that works well with each other and can own mistakes. I mean, mm-hmm. my God. We have a 5-person team and we are doing incredible things.
Yeah, you have transformed not only revenue, but dialogues. Mm. So I think maybe one question is you're talking not just about asking for money or support or creating opportunities. You're actually leading dialogues now around, okay, if we all get in the same room, I'm casting vision for others in the entire community. Talk a little bit about how you've found yourself in that place of, well, I'm going to cast vision for larger programs beyond our organization.
Yeah. I mean, I think that is the ability that fundraisers tend to have. They tend to always have that organization-wide look, whereas programs, people can really be looking at their programs in isolation. And it is our job to figure out a broader, larger message that people will buy so mm-hmm. that we get more unrestricted revenue in the door. And really, that's the why. That's mm-hmm. why people should be investing in your work.
Part of this work, though, is we're the ones that are out the door more than anybody else.
Yeah.
And we're put in positions where they're the sloppiest in the world because it's the human dynamic. Mm-hmm. And I'm going to program people, social, like in your work, there's a lot of human dynamic. But ours is a little different because they're supposed to be professional dynamics, right? You go in and all this, and everyone is an adventure of its own.
So true. And I'm used to not being the one talking.
Yeah.
Because if I'm talking too much, I'm not doing a good job on that visit.
You know, it's actually something you brought up earlier that I thought was really interesting, which you were talking about, you know, kind of that coming from that role of feeling like you had to know everything to really, which it's really more about doing a lot more of the talking than being the person who's listening to hear what the prospect has in mind, what they'd like to do. And I think it makes it a lot easier if you're coming into it with, I know this person, I've done some research, I understand their background a bit more, I know where they're coming from, so I kind of know the direction to lead the conversation. Mm-hmm. Rather than feeling like you have to throw everything in the kitchen sink out there going, which one do you like?
Yes.
Which one of these things attracts you to support?
And if you haven't picked up why Jim and I are beaming, if there was, you know, a little bit of wisdom, that's another piece of huge wisdom. How many questions do you ask compared to how many statements do you make now?
Oh, in God, a visit. I couldn't even tell you.
Right? When you start out, it's all statements. I got 100 statements ready to go. Yes. And now you're like, I've got 100 questions.
Exactly. And well, that is it.
And it changes everything.
Uh-huh. I always tell everyone, I'm like, it's my front-line fundraisers too. Yeah. When they get nervous about a prospect, I was just like, write down your 10 best questions. If you get nervous, just turn to those.
and you can literally pick them up
and
say, I thought about these. I want to ask you.
Yeah.
Well, it's authentic. Mm-hmm. And people see you have forethought. I'm getting chills. Ask more questions than prep more questions. That's the guy.
Oh, yes.
Agree. Especially the less I know about a topic, the more questions I'm going to ask. So, but that was that whole kind of, in my years of being in operational work on the data side of the house, And then moving into the development side of the house, I thought, you know, for years I supported the development activities. Like you talked about within your office, we had research. You've got a lot of the different areas where, you know, how do you make the transition from those roles into a development role? And I realized, oh my gosh, with all the key statistics and KPIs that we had, that we were asking our development teams to complete, now I was on the other side of it where I had a KPI of my own. I had so many people I had to go visit, calls, asks, et cetera, that I realized it's not easy.
Oh, no.
Development is not an easy job. But I did learn it became much easier when I realized that it wasn't about me. Oh. It's about the cause. Yeah. And if I could go in and help facilitate something that they'd like to do because of a great experience they had within the hospital or wherever it was, it became easier. Mm-hmm. So
I can't agree more. I mean, that's why you, on hard days, God, that's the only thing that keeps me going. My husband will say that too. Like, God, I really don't want to do this. And he's like, Chrissy, like, are the kids worth it? Yeah. The kids are, and I'm like, yes, the kids are worth it. Yes. What these kids have been through.
Yeah.
I can do the hard thing that I don't want to do. Call the donor who's upset or, you know, get my grant proposal done that night or whatever that hard activity is I don't want to do. Mm-hmm. You lean into your cause. It brings so much.
Lean into the cause. Yeah. And, you know, and this is where, you know, this is for all fundraisers, CEOs, board members, whoever wants to learn about it. Do you, what's the value, or maybe more direct, do you believe you can be the best of yourself without believing in the cause?
Oh, God, no.
Yeah.
No. I think that's always why I've been very particular about where I would work.
Yeah. Because you could, now you know enough of the craft, do you think you could fundraise pretty much anywhere? No questions asked.
But I don't know if I'd be successful at it.
Because it's, you are willing to go through the hard times and fundraising. Don't get me wrong, there's a lot of hard jobs out there. We just know there's this myth that fundraising is easy and is brutal.
No, it is brutal.
It's not your money, right? And you never know really why until you ask them. And you're held up to a lot of standards that you can't control.
Mm-hmm. So yeah, it is hard. And that's, I think that's why I said I would not be good for an organization I didn't feel passionate about. Yeah. Because it wouldn't be able to lift me up on those hard days. Because we do get beaten up a little bit.
Yep. Even when we're trying not to be.
Exactly.
It's just, and it's natural.
We try really hard not to be. But.
So just curious. What's your viewpoint on the stewardship aspects of your work? Mm-hmm. So you've developed this relationship on behalf of the organization. You've secured, you know, that gift. What do you feel that your role as a development officer is, or in a fundraiser is, in terms of the stewardship aspects of that work? Keeping that person informed or relevant to the cause?
I mean, that's critical. I think it's critical for deepening and maximizing any gift or relationship. I don't necessarily feel that if it's my relationship, I have to be the one who always comes up with the activity, the idea, you know, and actually in our team, we've kind of staffed that for someone who's really good at doing that. And then it gives us tools to be able to really engage those funders. So it is critical.
I like that.
Yeah, I didn't put in that words. Like, they're really good at the stewardship piece.
Yeah.
I have a friend of ours just happens to be really good at gift giving.
Yeah.
Why not hire someone that's really good at that and just max them out?
Yeah. I know. And it's worked for us. It's worked for us so far.
Yeah. And that was kind of leading to that, which I think there are personalities that are really good at going out and securing that gift. There's people that are wonderful at doing the stewardship pieces just as much as are people doing research and data analytics, all that stuff. I think that's a certain skill set. So that's why I was curious what your thoughts were on, as a fundraiser, doing that. And I think sometimes the larger organizations, the more you have that ability to allocate that out a little bit more, some of the smaller groups kind of have to do everything.
Mm-hmm. Yes. I've been in both.
Yeah.
But again, I think the larger you get, the more important team selling is, because it gets harder and harder to feel like you're all a part of that victory.
Yeah.
So you have to be conscious about it, how you design it and how you work for it.
Now, so you use the word selling, and I will do that a lot as well. Why do you prefer that over the term fundraising?
Well, quite honestly, it's, I think, a position that fundraisers need to take, that it's more of an active position, whereas I feel like so many times people are like, I'm in fundraising, and they're just like, oh, if I create the best pamphlet, or if I come up with the most creative campaign, money will come in, and that is just not the way it happens. You can't put something out there and just hope that the sky is going to pour down money. You know, it has to be more direct. It has to be targeted. You need to do your research.
Yep.
You need to make sure that you're spending your time in front of the right person if you want to get that gift.
I love the frame of vocabulary. It's not just a word to you. It's a position of attitude, position of responsibility.
Yes.
And I know great fundraisers use fundraising thing, but for you, I could tell that sales word is something you've
It helped with the shift, really, I think, because I had been one of those catchment, like, what are we doing? How do we do this better? And then really with some training and mentoring, I was like, oh, this is really an attitude shift.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what the organization needs. And that's where fundraisers get their special powers to be the thought leaders, to really help bring in the revenue and the types of revenue that the organization needs to thrive. And you have to have those conversations with the funders, too, because you might be like, someone might just want to fund this one program, but your organization really needs an unrestricted gift. And how do you marry that? And how do you get someone to maybe shift their thinking a little bit more? And you really,
I love that one, because your relationship with an individual may generate a gift, but maybe not be the gift that you needed to get.
Oh yeah.
But it just happens to be where their passions are at. So do I create a fund just for that specific thing, just so I can secure the gift? Or do I try to help steer that in a different direction to help our mission further its cause for what we need?
Yeah. Well, how do you think about that? What's your role, responsibility, both for the organization and the prospect in that moment?
Oh, in that moment, it is, and that's why I love being a fundraising leader, is it really is, at this level, you have to understand the cost of taking a gift to the organization that might not be in line with what you need. And if pursuing a gift and taking that cost is gonna, like in my current organization, with how complicated our funding streams are and how little unrestricted revenue we get for operations, that really is
significant.
Yeah. A $50,000 gift, which sounds great in my revenue bucket, but makes our operations and programs seed deviate. It's not necessarily what it is. And so I think it is about when you're talking about your organization and your impact and your path to that impact, it's about being honest. It's about understanding what's holding your organization back and what can unleash it. And then how maybe a different type of gift could eventually enable our organization to take on that $50,000 to do that program.
Yeah.
So really bringing them in to where you are at this point in your organizational journey. And you know, especially when you're working with people who've been successful with their own businesses,
they get it. They get it.
Yeah.
And it's nice to be able to lean on them.
And they probably, and I really like leadership. You have to lead because the prospect doesn't know what you actually need.
Yes.
They're just trying to be helpful.
Exactly.
And when you lead, they're not only seeing it, I get it. I got my own company. That makes sense. But they're also seeing someone lead and people invest and they're willing to build trust around that.
That's very true.
Well done. Isn't it fun?
I never thought of myself that way, but I'm like, it's very true.
Well, as we start to wind down this conversation, I wanted to kind of ask, as we always do in our Moving Fundraising Forward podcast, is that takeaway. What would be the one takeaway you might have for somebody who's considering going into fundraising as a profession?
Well, I would definitely say look into it and see if your passions and your qualities could be, you know, a good fit towards that. Because my God, we need more and we need great fundraisers out there. There are so many causes that could be transformational with the right person, with the right attitude coming in and really dedicating themselves to understanding the craft, which is not rocket science, and then really taking that passion out there to connect more funders. And if you aren't that person who loves to meet and be in front of people, there are so many different roles in development that are really, really, really needed.
Yeah.
And so worthwhile, because the way you get to interact with the impact and the programs and influence that is just, it's so meaningful.
Mm-hmm.
It really feels like more of a thought partnership when you do fundraising right.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, internally and externally.
Yes.
Yeah. I mean, that's the fun thing. I got to meet with Chrissy's team a couple times here, and it was just this idea that they knew if I did better research, that would buy this much more time for Chrissy's team to go this. Well, if I did this, you know, if I did this program faster, I could buy back 5 hours. That 5 hours could translate into $5,000 gift from a new prospect this year.
Mm-hmm.
And just the way they all saw it coming together, it was truly team sales.
Yeah.
Yeah. Just well done.
I love that. It's we provide a lot of managed services for a lot of organizations across the country, and our way of being a part of that success is knowing that for, you know, everything that we're doing on the administrative side of the house to support that effort relieves them of that much time to go out and spend with potential prospect to fund something that helps people in those communities. And so in a roundabout way, we're providing that that support.
Yeah.
And that's fun to be a part of. That's something that feels good at the end of the day to go home and know, I know it was a rough day.
Yeah.
But you know, we're helping people.
I know.
And I'll kind of from my takeaway, I want to echo, if you're in a leadership role, you have to be in a safe place to do it, but share when you didn't do it perfectly.
Oh, yes.
It is like the way you talked about it and watching your team respond to it, it's really magical what happens because now they're not afraid to come forward. And as a leader, if you hear about an issue, you know, 10 minutes after it happens, it's a lot different than a month after it happens.
Exactly.
And a really good team, they'll tell you the issue before it happens.
Oh,
right? You're like, I'm worried about this visit. I think I'm going to screw it up. Perfect. Uh-huh. Tell me more. Or I'm worried I'm going to send the wrong email. Or I'm worried I'm going to say the wrong. Perfect. Tell me more. So that was just one of your nuggets of wisdom that was just fantastic today.
Well, thank you, Adam. Yeah.
So if people want to get involved with Raise the Future, how would they do that?
Yes. Okay. I would suggest going to our website, which is raisethefuture.org. There's so much information if you're interested in fostering or fostering to adopt. There's that whole avenue, really hands-on. And, you know, always we are looking for volunteers to help us with support with events, to help us just kind of continue to get the word out there about children who are waiting in foster care and really the relationships that they need to thrive. So that would be my hope and suggestion.
That's an amazing cause. I did a lot of research on that one, and it's just you guys are doing great work. So
thank you.
Thank you very much for joining us today.
Yeah, thank you.
Great to have you, Chrissy. You are a rock star.
Thank you both. It was an honor.
Thank you. For more information about Moving Fundraising Forward, please email us at info@movingfundraisingforward.com. And as always,
no question is off the table. That's what we're here for. The crazier, the better.
All right. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
This podcast is brought to you by Cause and Solution, Inc. and Peak Coaching and Training Solutions. For more information or to send your questions and suggestions, please email us at info@movingfundraisingforward.com. And as always, thank you for listening.